Bibles this morning. Actually, we're going to be in several scriptures. The heart of the scripture that we'll be in will be Matthew chapter 10, but we're not going to get to Matthew chapter 10 for just a little while. Actually, we're going to meander around some, as I want to talk just a little bit today about the character of Jesus. I started last week, and I mentioned to you that throughout the year 2017, our focus on these Sunday morning sermons is going to be our Lord Jesus Christ, and we're going to learn the aspects of Jesus's ministry and how they apply to our lives. But before we get into walking through the Gospels and walking through those particular passages of Scripture, I want us to consider the character of Jesus. Not the activity of Jesus, not the teaching of Jesus, but the character, the personality of Jesus. Last week we looked at Jesus as one of strength. He was the one whom John the Baptist, who was as strong as there ever was, said, "One is coming after me who is greater or mightier than I." We looked at Simon Peter and Andrew and James and John, the sweat and sinew of the fishermen, and yet they immediately dropped everything they have and followed him. We looked at his character of strength last week. I want to look today at a character trait I'll call sincerity. Sincerity, or maybe candor would be a better word as you look at it, but I want to use both of those words today. When we think about sincerity, we often don't think about it in the manner in which I am going to present it today. That's why I'm giving you an option of candor, perhaps. Because if you meet someone, you say, "Well, you know, he sure is sincere." Typically, what you mean is, well, he means well, right? I mean, he's soft-hearted, and he really has a desire. He's a sincere person, and that's a good character trait, but it's not necessarily the one that I'm going to look at today. In fact, after I had you turn to Matthew chapter 10, why don't you go ahead and just put that string in the Bible and turn back to John, the 14th chapter. And let me show you an example of the sincerity or the candor of Jesus that I want us to consider today. And I think that you'll understand then, right from the beginning, the sincerity of Jesus. John, the 14th chapter. It's a familiar passage of Scripture, and when you get there, you'll understand it, you'll know it right away. It is that Scripture which says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me." I could almost stop and preach this passage because it's such a beautiful passage. But he goes on in verse 2 to say, "In my Father's house are many mansions." Now here's what I want you to pick up. "If it were not so, I would have," what? "Told you. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye might be also." Beautiful passage of comfort and encouragement. But to introduce this morning's sermon, it's those words that I want you to consider right there. "If it were not so, I would have told you." That's the character trait that I want to pick up on Jesus today, is he is so sincere that if there is some information that you need to know, what's he going to do? He's going to tell us. "If it weren't so, I would have told you." He is so sincere that he is not going to hold back information, nor is he even going to hold back his opinion, his attitude, his evaluation of a matter, but rather he is going to tell you. Now, I think that in so many ways you ought to become like Jesus. I'm not, as you know, if you've listened to me much, I'm not a big fan of the WWJD, what would Jesus do, because I think we'll have to walk on water and heal the sick and raise the dead and cast out demons and all these other kind of things, because that's what Jesus would do, and frankly, I'm not Jesus. But I do think that as we look to Jesus, there are some character traits that we see in him that we ought to say, if that's the character of Jesus, the Son of God, that's the character I want as well. And I think one of the character traits that I want us to pick up on today is the candor or the sincerity of Jesus. That is, Jesus is going to open up his mouth and he is going to tell us that which we need to know. Now, I think, and this is my evaluation, and some of this maybe is changing just a little bit, but there is a very strong sense in which we live in an insincere world, don't we? By insincere, let me just give you a couple of examples. Do you ever say things that you don't believe? Nobody wants to admit it, but sure, all the time we say things that we don't believe. Or let me just give an example. How are you today? Fine. Okay, that question and that answer just go together almost perfectly. We hear it, we ask it all the time, we hear it all the time. How are you today? Fine. How many of you have ever said fine when the truth was you are anything but fine? Well, yeah, we do it all the time. And, you know, my toe hurts and my brain quit and all that kind of stuff. And yet we just give that answer, fine. And we do that maybe because we know that they didn't want to know how we were anyway. So we know that it wasn't really a sincere question to begin with, and so we won't give them a sincere answer, you know. We know people who really do mean it when they ask, you know, how are you doing, and they know the background and the situation and all that, and we're much more sincere with them. But the average person coming down the street, how are you doing today? I find myself doing it all the time, you know. I just oftentimes, almost always, I walk to the post office instead of drive to the post office. That's because it's quicker in time. New Mexico to walk to the post office than it is to drive to the post office. So as I walk, I see other passersby as they're walking. And so often I just say, how are you today? And do you know, I'd be so shocked if somebody actually stopped and told me how they were doing. Okay, just be honest. Furthermore, I'm not even sure what I would do or if I really want to know how they're doing. I'm headed to the post office. I got places to go, people to see. I don't care how you're doing, right? I hate to believe that. Ken, excuse me, as a pastor, I would stop everything, have a cup of coffee, and I don't even drink coffee, but I'd have a cup of coffee, and we'd just have, you know, 2 hours maybe of sharing. I'm so sincere. Okay, you guys are the same way, so it doesn't matter, right? That's the kind of world that we live in. I think we not only say things that we don't believe from time to time, maybe more often than we'd like to admit, but sometimes we don't say what we do believe, too, right? I mean, every one of us has been in that situation where, you know, what do you like this dress? It's lovely. Right? We say things we don't believe all the time. And we do that out of a lack of sincerity. Sometimes we have even emotions that we don't express, or we express an emotion that we don't have. Right? And we know we're supposed to be excited, and so, hey, you know, paint on the face and put on glee, you know, I'm excited. Or you know, we know we're supposed to be frustrated or upset or whatever, and we express an emotion we don't feel, or we have an emotion we don't express. Either one of those things, saying something you didn't believe, not saying something you did believe, having a feeling you didn't express, or expressing a feeling you didn't have, all that kind of stuff is a lack of sincerity. And sometimes, you know, we think one thing and yet we're saying something else all while we're thinking it. And that's the, excuse me, the kind of lack of sincerity that is part and parcel of our world today. It's just people in the church, godly people, wonderful people, pastors even, have accustomed ourselves to this lack of sincerity or lack of candor. And I think as we look through Jesus, and as I mentioned last week, we don't have you know, every word and activity of Jesus, but from what we've got recorded of him, he seemed to be a person who said exactly what he felt, and when he felt something, he said it. Right? And so his sincerity in that manner, or his candor in that manner, was something that is very, very clear to us. I suppose that our society doesn't much completely care for plain spokenness. Now, I know in a sense we say, oh, I value someone who speaks their mind. Unless they're speaking their mind and it's against our mind, right? Then we'd rather than not speak their mind. And we just have a society that lacks candor a little bit. Now, let's talk about the word candor and the word sincere. Candor actually comes not from the Greek. You're surprised, right? You expected me to go there. Candor comes from the Latin candore, and it's almost a direct borrow from Latin candore. And there's a couple of words that come from candore. One is candor, but the other, it may surprise you, the other word is candidate. Candidate. We just come through an election year. This week we're going to inaugurate a new president. We know all about what it is to be a candidate, don't we? How in the world does candidate come from candore? Well, the candidate in the original, in the Latin, the candidate to the Roman Senate would come and stand before the Senate, and they would stand there in a white robe. It was the white robe that showed, I'm pure, what you see is what you get, I'm candore, and candore is pure and bright and white. That is candore. Now, I know that you're kind of confused and say, well, I haven't seen a candidate yet who is pure and white and bright, right? But we carried over into modern English, we carried over the candore who came, the man who came dressed candore, pure, bright, and white, we carried that over to the guy who's running for an election ought to be candid. Now, any other election year, I could have said, rarely do we have a candid candidate, right? This year, sometimes we wondered if he should be quite that candid, right? But what we hope to have in a politician is, or a candidate for a particular office, is they really are going to tell us their convictions. What is it they believe? What is it they were going to do? We want a candidate who would say, if it were not so, I would have told you. That is candore. That's what we want in a candidate. It's rare to find, and I think to this day we don't know if we've got it, right? It's one of these things you only kind of know in the background is, did you really say what you meant, right? Read my lips. No, oh, never mind. I didn't mean to go there. So sometimes we say something very clearly, but it's not really what we mean. Candidate comes from there. There's another word that comes from candor, by the way, and that is the word candle. How in the world is a candle and a candidate and all that? Well, candore is to put off a bright light. And so we get candle. Now, a candle will put off a light that will sometimes burn you, right? But it nonetheless puts out that light. And Jesus, when I say Jesus was candid, I mean that you got the light. You got the light that sometimes burned. You got the light that sometimes gave warmth. You got the light that sometimes gave the ability to see. There are different aspects to a candle, and there are different aspects to the candid nature of Jesus Christ. And so he comes very candid. And our goal today is that we become more like Jesus. More candid, that is, more open to expressing our real feelings and our real thoughts and putting those into words that will help others. You know, I think one of the weaknesses of the church today is it has hidden its true feelings. And it hid the true feelings so long that it even forgot it had those feelings, right? We hid the Word of God and buried the Word of God and the convictions that come from the Word of God because we knew the world didn't really want us to be that candid, right? And we knew that how in the world are we going to build a big crowd if we're that candid? And so we took many of the things of Jesus and the things of the Scripture. And we set those aside. First of all, we set them aside not on Sunday morning. We'll do that on Sunday night. Then we said not on Sunday morning or Sunday night. We'll do that on Wednesday night. Then we said not Sunday morning, Sunday night, or Wednesday night. We'll do that in a book that you can buy at a seminary bookstore. And, you really have to dig in order to find something somewhere that is there. And we quit being candid. I think that when we quit being candid, we quit being like Jesus, honestly. And we need to be more candid, or I use the other word I started out with. We need to be more sincere. Jesus was sincere. Now, Sincere also comes from Latin. I know you don't feel like you got your money's worth if you don't get some foreign words. And so sincere also comes from sincere. And some of you know in the Spanish language, of course, the Spanish word sin, S-I-N, sin, means what? Without, that's right. Spanish is, of course, a Latin language. Sin, sere. Sere happens to be wax. Wax. Sincere literally means without wax. It's nice, isn't it? He's very sincere. Doesn't have any wax. How in the world did it come about? Well, it came about in the art world, actually, in the world of sculpting. And in the world of sculpting, when you took a piece of wood or a stone and you made a beautiful work of art, what happens if you mess up? Well, you would melt down some wax, fill it in, brush it over, cover it up, and the wax would fix your mistake. And the finest artists, of course, didn't want to have to deal with something that was all patched up with wax. They wanted to be able to say, what I've got doesn't have any flaws in it. It doesn't have any mistakes. Now, you put them side by side, and you're not going to be able to tell the difference because this one, it's got all covered up and glossed over, but underneath is wax, and you set that thing out in the sun, and someday it's going to come through. The flaw is going to come through. But I've got that which is, they would sign their name, and then they would put sincere, sincere. This is the sincere thing. This is the one without wax. Now, I think Jesus is one of those, as you study his life and read his words, he's one of those that he doesn't have any wax, right? If it were not so, I would have told you. He puts it out there, just plain spoken. Here it is. What you see is what you get, and you've got it. Now, how many of you, taking that definition of sincere and that definition of candor, how many of you know someone who's somewhat candid? They are that what you see is what you get kind of person. Think about that. I mean, everybody, there's a few of those people around, right? And you know these people. If they think something, they're going to say it. If they feel something, they're going to say it. Now, there is an aspect of that you like, don't you? And yet, I can almost guarantee, even though I don't know who you're thinking of, there's another aspect of that in which you say, I wish you'd keep your feelings to yourself. I wish you wouldn't be so candid. I wish you wouldn't put so much light on the subject. To put it in using the Latin, I wish you'd shut up, right? This is that person sometimes that speaks in that kind of very candid, without wax kind of speak. And we all know those people. Well, those people typically, if you get to know them, you kind of like them. And you begin to appreciate the fact that, hey, they're candid. This is who they are. And you also excuse them sometimes. So you say, oh, he's candid. You know, that's who he is or who she is. And sometimes I have a friend who's very candid. He's perhaps the most candid guy I've ever met. And often I will introduce him to someone. He doesn't live here, by the way, so don't worry if it's you. I will introduce him to someone, and after I introduce them, sometimes to his face, but a lot of times afterwards, I say, now he's going to say something that's going to offend you. If you'll give him about 10 minutes, he's going to offend you. Because that's the way, he doesn't have this governor on his mouth like the rest of us do. He just, if he thinks it or feels it, boom, out it comes. And so you just need to understand that's who it is. And typically I say, the best way to deal with him is you do the same thing. Because he's expecting you to be just as candid to him as he's being candid to you. And if you do this, you two are going to have a wonderful relationship, and you're going to find he's the smartest guy ever, and you're going to love him, and you're going to appreciate him. But if you don't understand this, you are going to be offended, lock, stock, and barrel here in about 8 minutes, and you're going to be out of here and say, that's the worst son of a gun to ever walk the face of this earth. Now, that's the way candid people are, right? And I'm kind of convinced, by the way, that that's the way Jesus was. That he was so candid that some people absolutely loved it and others didn't. You take candid people in our world today, and candid people in our world today are loved and hated on extremes, right? Who loves the candid person? Well, typically the one who agrees with what they have said. And the one who says, finally, someone said what needed to be spoken, right? We love that. As long as we agreed with it. If we didn't agree with it, then we say, he's not my candidate, you know, he's not my president, he's not my, and there's an animosity against that. And so we see that, I think, very much in the life of Jesus. Well, let's look at a couple of examples from the scripture. Again, we'll eventually get into Matthew, but look at John chapter 1, beginning in verse 45. The Gospel of John, chapter 1. It has this beautiful little story that I appreciate so much. One time I didn't really understand it, wasn't sure exactly what was going on. But in John chapter 1, beginning in verse 45, Philip has just been introduced to Jesus. Philip believes he's the Messiah. And in verse 45, it says, Philip findeth Nathanael and saith unto him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, you remember this, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Jesus said, come and see. Now, Nathanael, I'm convinced Nathanael was one who was looking for the Messiah. Really, all the Jewish people were looking for the Messiah. But Philip said, hey, I know Nathanael's looking for the Messiah. He'll be excited. He'll be one of the first that wants to know. And so everything that Philip said was good. We have found him, Moses, the law, the prophets. He did right. And then he said, Jesus of Nazareth. And Nathanael, right then said, forget about everything else you said. You said, Jesus of Nazareth. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Nathanael, by the way, was from Cana in Galilee. And Cana in Galilee had animosity towards those in Nazareth. The people in Nazareth and the people in Cana didn't get along. They were rivals, so to speak. And Cana was down in the valley. Nazareth was up on the mountain. And it was just, you know, one of these things that went on. Every town has the neighboring town they hate, right? And this is one of those things that Nazareth was the neighboring town that Cana hated. So can anything good come out of Nazareth? And it goes on in verse 46. He concludes and says, come and see. Verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said, behold, an Israelite in whom is no, what? Guile or deceit on some of the other translations. And since we don't use the word guile very often, it means deceit. And what is a person who doesn't have deceit? A person who doesn't have deceit doesn't deceive. A person who doesn't deceive is sincere, no wax on them. A person who doesn't deceive is candid, full of candore. And so here Jesus says, behold, an Israelite in whom there is no guile. I don't know if the rest of the Israelites sort of covered things up and spun it and had to, put a smile on their face or whatever. But Jesus was so clear, here is Nathanael, an Israelite who is going to be very candid. He is going to say exactly what he thinks, exactly what he feels, even towards the one who's been introduced to him as the Messiah. If he's from Nazareth, I'm going to question it all day long till the cows come home. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And Jesus likes Nathanael. He celebrates Nathanael. The fact that here's an Israelite in whom there is no guile. I like a guy who speaks his mind, is what Jesus is saying. I like a guy who doesn't just, swallow it hook, line, and sinker. He's not, hey, here's an Israelite who's gullible. Let's take him. We need gullible people on our team. No, that's not what he says. Here's an Israelite in whom there is no guile. And Jesus looks at this and Jesus celebrates this. And it becomes, this very beautiful picture. In fact, another example, you remember that Jesus says, as the little children were coming unto him, and the disciples said, said, no, put the little children away. You don't have time for them. And Jesus said what? Let the little children come to me. Let the little children come to me. Now, I know I'm probably reading a little bit into this, so you can skip this part if you want to. But what is it about the little children Jesus likes? Maybe what it is about the little children Jesus likes is little children are candid, aren't they? Little children are sincere. They don't have any wax on them. Little children don't have that governor on their mouth that says, don't say that. Little children are just going to put it like it is. One of the things that, as a pastor, when I've visited with so many little children, of course, over the years, and someone will bring their child to me and say, you know, I think my child's ready to accept Jesus Christ, or my child has accepted Jesus Christ, was ready to be baptized, and we'll have a little visit, and I'll talk to them about the things of the Lord and a relationship and the free gift of God. And somewhere along the way, of course, we talk about sin and talk about, you know, I say, what is sin? And sin is doing what's bad. Sin is being disobedient against God, you know, all these things. And then, of course, I talk about, well, who is a sinner? And so usually I'll say, you know, the Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. I say, well, who is all? And they say, well, all means everybody. And I then say, well, what about you? Have you sinned? And, you know, they'll be a little shy about it maybe, but, that, you know, they'll come up with it. And then here's my favorite thing to do. Mom or Dad sitting there, maybe both of them, and I'll say, what about Dad? And immediately the confessions begin to flow. And Dad begins to sink down into the couch and under the coffee table as the child is pouring forth the sins of the dad. And it comes out so quickly. And I know it's a little trap. I just wanted to find out what Dad was up to. But a child, they will do that. They will carry that out so quickly, won't they? And so Jesus says, I like Nathaniel. I like the little children. I like those who are going to speak that which is on their mind. Let the little children come to me. And yet, these are who Jesus liked. He liked Nathanael. He liked the little children. But who did he not like? Think about the Pharisees. And the Pharisees came to him at one point, and he called the Pharisees hypocrites. You hypocrites. That's pretty candid, isn't it? Hypocrite actually comes from the Greek. And the word means under a mask, honestly, but it was used for the term of actor or actress. In a Greek play, the hypocrites were the one up on stage. They were the actors and the and actresses. I'll get it out here. And so in Greek, hypocrite didn't really have the negative connotation that it does today, not any more than actor or actress, which has more negative of connotation all the time, right? But it didn't have really a negative connotation. It was just, you know, you actors. That is, you're pretending. You got this mask on, but you're not really what you say. You're not sincere. You're not candid. You're going to say what the people want said. You're going to do what the people want done. You know, you're going to act all Mr. Holy, but we know down deep in there's you know, on the outside you're all polished, but the inside is gunk. You're a whitewashed tomb, look like a nice little cottage with a picket fence on the outside, but inside you're a coffin. That's what you are. And so Jesus called them hypocrites. I've always wondered, by the way, and I don't know this for sure, but I've always wondered if the animosity of the word hypocrite actually comes from that very passage in the scripture. Because hypocrite, again, used to just be a neutral word. It just meant a person who is an actor. But now, you almost can't use the word hypocrite without putting a lot of anger and feeling and emotion into it, right? You hypocrite. I mean, it just comes along with it. And I wonder if it didn't come from this very phrase that we began to associate hypocrite with the Pharisees, and we begin to use this word. So Jesus doesn't like the hypocrite, and it's almost like Jesus took a very common word and he cursed it in using that. And let me look at another example. Go to Matthew chapter 22, beginning verse 23. Matthew 22:23. And here is not the Pharisees, but the Sadducees. And Here the scripture says, the same day came unto him the Sadducees, which say there is no resurrection, and asked him, saying, Master, Moses said, if a man die having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up the seed of his brother. That's true. Moses did say that. Verse 25. Now there were with us seven brethren, and the first, when he had married a wife, deceased, and having no issue, left his wife to his brother, likewise the second, and the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, and the sixth, and the seventh, and last of all, the woman also died. Verse 28, therefore in the resurrection, whose wife shall she be of the seven? For they all had her. Now, let me ask you a question. Is that a sincere question? No, it's not sincere. It's a trap question, perhaps. It's what I call an agenda-driven question. And I have a rule against agenda-driven questions in our home, especially when the kids are around. No agenda-driven questions allowed. No agenda-driven statements. You just better say what you want or it's not coming. I had an example with Nathan just the other day, and now I've forgotten it. I wish I could come up with it because it was really good. If I stand here long enough, it'll come to me. Maybe. I'm getting older. Used to come. But in our home, if you want a hamburger for supper, you better say, I want a hamburger for supper. If you hint about it, we don't go there. You got to come out and say it. And I learned that as we were raising the kids, hey, be candid. But, you know, put it out there. No, let's not dance around this whole thing. Let's just put it out there. What is it that you really want? Well, the Sadducees, they were the best at agenda-driven questions. And I was still to this day, I mean, I've been trapped. This is maybe one of the reasons I'm so sensitive about it. I've been trapped a number of times by agenda-driven questions. You probably have been too. So I've learned when a person asks a question, I go through this process in my mind, hopefully fairly quickly, and say, does this person want information or is this person after something else? If they want information, I'm good with it. But often, you know, in your world as well as mine, they're not wanting information because they already know what the answer is. But they want me to speak the answer so then they can tramp on the answer, right? I mean, you got that in your world, in your home, whatever, it's all that. Well, this is where the Sadducees were. And I know they didn't really care whose wife she was going to be in the resurrection right from the beginning. Look at verse 23 again. It says, the same day came the Sadducees, which say what? There is no resurrection. Sadducees didn't believe in a resurrection. So they didn't care whose wife she was going to be in the resurrection because there was no resurrection for them. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. That's why they're sad, you see. I know that's so bad, but it works every time. So, if you don't believe in a resurrection, don't ask a question about the resurrection because it's just being used to devise this trap. So Jesus, he doesn't answer the question, whose wife she's going to be in the resurrection. Why answer an agenda-driven question? In fact, what Jesus does is very candid. Notice in verse 29, Jesus answered and said to them, what? Ye do err. That's very nice King James to say, wrong, we're not going there. Ye do err, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. Sadducees, old religious PhDs up there looking so high and mighty, you don't know the scripture, you don't know God. Now, look how it continues. Jump down to verse 33. When the multitude heard this, they were astonished at his doctrine. But when the Pharisees heard it, now catch this, that he had put the Sadducees to silence. They were gathered together, and one of them brings forth a question, tempting, that is, another agenda-driven question. The Pharisees said, Sadducees couldn't get him, let's try it. When he had put them to silence. That's candid, isn't it? That's sincere. Now, especially it seems like in the Christian world, what we're supposed to do is, work with them a little bit, meet them where they are and sort of carry them gently along. But Jesus just never did do that, did he? He was so blunt because he knew exactly where it was that they were coming from. Well, I think when you study again the words of Jesus and the actions of Jesus, what you see is the sincerity of Jesus, especially in his speech, which is about the only thing we have to go by. And in his speech, he had there's a lot of the speech of Jesus that was filled with condemnation, wasn't there? You don't know the scriptures. You don't know the power of God. You vipers, you snakes, you liars, you hypocrites, you blind fools. Don't you know that if Jesus had been on CNN after saying those things, they would have said, let's say his advisor was on CNN, they would have said to his advisor, do you kind of cringe when Jesus speaks like that? Do you ever try to hold Jesus back and get him not to talk like that? is that really Christ-like for Jesus to call someone a blind fool? And yet, he's Christ, he's the standard, isn't it? And this is exactly what he was doing, and we want to say, hey, whoa, Jesus, don't go there. Don't be quite so candid. And yet being candid is part of his character. It is who he is. And our problem is we like to take white and black and make gray, don't we? We're a lot more comfortable in a gray zone than we are in white or black. And so we bring these together. Think of the Pharisaical system for just a moment. And in the Pharisaical system, they had this crazy means of oath-taking that they had brought about, that you can, swear on the gold of the temple, but you can't swear on the temple itself. And all these little, it made as much sense as, when you're a little kid and you say, I promise I will. But then the promise didn't matter, did it? Why? I had my fingers crossed. So the promise doesn't matter. And Jesus, in his commentary on that, said what? Let your yes be yes and your no, no. Away with all this garbage. Say what you mean. Mean what you say. Here's Jesus, very candid in all that he does, candid in his words. You remember the very first miracle that Jesus produced, and Mary calls her son Jesus and says, hey, we're out of wine, you need to do something. And the words are, woman, what do I have to do with you? That's a little uncomfortable, isn't it? Jesus, you don't talk like that to your mother? And we look at that, and the best we preachers can do is to read it fast and move on. Hoping people just think, well, it's kind of King James-ish. But whether it's King James or it's in the Greek, it's all pretty blunt there. Woman, what do I have to do with you? And Jesus, when you put it together theologically, Jesus is at the point where he is now saying, I am about my Father's business. And even if you're my mother, I don't take orders from anybody. Except if he says it, I say it. If he says do it, I go out and do it. Very candid, all the way through from the beginning of his ministry to the end. Well, I'm out of time, and I come to Matthew chapter 10, where I told you to go in the very beginning, right? Let's just jump through very quickly some of these scriptures, and I want you again to see the candid nature of our Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 10, verse 5. Jesus is sending the 12 out, and he says, these 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not the way of the Gentiles, or unto the city of the Samaritans enter ye not. Pretty candid, isn't it? Racist too. Don't go to the Gentiles. Don't go to the Samaritans. Jump down to verse 9. Provide neither gold nor silver nor brass in your purses nor scrip for your journey, neither two coats, neither shoes, nor yet staves, for the workman is worthy of his meat. Go out there and let other people pay for you. That's what I want you to do. Go to the Jews, let them pay for you. Verse 12. When you come into a house, salute it. If that house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it be not worthy, let your peace return to you. Shake the dust off your feet. Get out of there, he says. It's pretty candid, isn't it? Down in verse 12. I already read that. Verse 16. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Verse 22. Ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end, he shall be saved. Verse 25. It's enough for the disciples that he be as his master and the servant if he be as his Lord. If they call the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of the household? Fear them not, therefore. For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed and hid that shall not be made known. Verse 34, think not that I came to send peace on the earth. I came not to send peace, but the sword. All of that just to say, here is a chapter in which Jesus is about as blunt as he can be, right? I want you to go to certain people. I don't want you to go to other people. I don't want you to go to the Gentiles. Remember when that Gentile woman came along and said, hey, could I have healing for my son? And he said, I'm not going to take the pearls and throw it before the swine. I'm not going to give the food on the table to the dog. That's, shall we say, a little too candid. And yet, theologically, it was a necessity. And Jesus is saying, I've promised something to one group of people. If I were to take now that which I promised to them and give it to you, what kind of integrity would that be? What kind of promise would that be? And so Jesus very bluntly says, I will not waver from my promise. Even if it hurts someone, even if it offends someone, I'm sticking by my promise. That was the candid nature of our Lord. Well, as we come and conclude this sermon and say, okay, Jesus was a man of strength. We saw that last week. Here, Jesus is a man who of candor, of sincerity. And we begin to look and say, I need to work some of that into my life. Now, there are maybe a few of you who are listening who are strong as goat's breath already. I don't want you to overdo it. But most of us need to work on it on this regard just a little bit, don't we? Most of us are... use the illustration, most of us have a little more wax than we want others to know. We're not quite as sincere or as bright and pure as we would like it to be. And most of us need to come and pray, Lord, help me to know what needs to be said and to have the courage to say it. Help me to have the backbone to stick up when all the world may be going a different direction and I feel convicted about this. Help me not to just shrink back and be, a flower on the wall, but rather to be like an Esther who comes up in such a time as this and speaks mine. So I think we ought to be like Paul, who over and over again said, pray for me that I might be bold, that I might have candor, that I might be sincere. And I hope that you will pray for me and I'll pray for you, that we will be candid just like Jesus. Let's pray together.